Welcome back, class. Yeah, it's me, it's Mr. Betts. Okay, I usually like to have some kind of gimmick when I do these videos, and Halloween is next week, and I thought, hey, I bought this sweet Spider-Man suit, might as well get two uses out of it. If you like it, you can buy one too, link down in the description. Now I'm realizing, like, unless you watch it as soon as the video comes out, this isn't really gonna make any sense, but that doesn't matter, because in 10 minutes, you have a test on Washington, Adams, and Jefferson, and I'm gonna go over 50 terms, events, and people that you're going to need to know. And just in case you don't have a test on all three of those administrations, you can click to the appropriate time code right here, and away we go! You're gonna need to know Article 2 of the US Constitution, and it's all about the new executive branch, which is led by the president. So after the Constitution is ratified by New Hampshire, the ninth and last needed state to do so, it's time to pick a president, which is done in the election of 1789 that sees George Washington unanimously win. How is that even possible? Firstly, George Washington was basically God to early Americans, and secondly, we need to look at the Electoral College, which back then saw each elector cast votes for two candidates. Yeah, the vote wasn't cast as a president-vice president combo, so Washington got one of the two votes from every elector, and the distant second place finisher, John Adams, he became the VP. Now, one of the first decisions Washington would have to make is how to fill his cabinet. You know, the leaders of these early departments and offices inside of the executive branch. Most notable were the departments and their heads. Take Thomas Jefferson, who led the State Department, which conducted relations with other countries. Pretty important considering how new we were as a country. You have Henry Knox, who served as the first Secretary of the Department of War, now called the Department of Defense, because that sounds nicer, right? And Alexander Hamilton, who was the Secretary of the Department of the Treasury, which handles the financial matters of the nation, and he would have his work cut out for him right off the bat due to the national debt, or the money that the country owed. And while this new constitutional government might have been okay, the old Confederation government had ran up quite a pretty big bill. And how much ran up varied from state to state. Now, if we just said whatever, then the country would have no credit to borrow and thus grow. Simply put, we'd be that friend that's always borrowing money, never pays it back, so nobody gives them money anymore. Hamilton proposed that the national government pay all money owed to all countries and American citizens, and this led to the District of Columbia becoming the nation's capital. How? Well, southern states on average ran down a much lower debt in exchange for them getting on board with the nation pays the majority northern debt. They wanted the nation's capital out of the north, and that's why it's in a swamp on the Virginia-Maryland border. The Bank of the United States, another one of Hamilton's idea, would be created to build a strong economy. Now, it would allow both the government and private investors to own stock in it. The problem was, as pointed out by folks like Jefferson, the Constitution didn't quite say that a bank like this could be created, and it would mostly just benefit the wealthy, but whatever, it was still created. Hamilton figured that these were implied powers, powers that were not expressly forbidden. I mean, Congress can issue money and regulate trade. Why can't it have a bank? And Hamilton still wasn't done. He pushed for protective tariffs and new taxes on products like whiskey, which led to the Whiskey Rebellion, a 1794 violent protest by Pennsylvanian farmers / whiskey distillers. Washington's response? He personally led the army to break up the rebellion and to prove that this new government was no joke. The Battle of Fallen Timbers also saw the army get some action as they took on and defeated 1,000 Native Americans in what is now Ohio. They might have even seen more action, this time with Spain, if not for the Picquigny Treaty of 1795. This gave Americans the use of the Mississippi River and the right to trade in New Orleans. Maybe we should try to buy that city. You know what? We better put it on our to-do list. First, we have to figure out how the new national court system worked, what with the Judiciary Act of 1789. That set up the federal court system. States still had their courts, but federal courts could reverse their decisions. Washington and the young country also had to figure out their role internationally. You see, the French, partially inspired by us, were beginning the French Revolution. Yay! More rights to the people, right? Until it started getting really violent and bloody and chaotic. England, as well as the rest of Europe, was getting pretty nervous, and they all started fighting. France thought that we'd have their back, what with the Franco-American Alliance of 1778, which pretty much is the reason that we won the revolution in the first place. But yeah, France, you were acting pretty crazy, so Washington issued the Proclamation of Neutrality. This forbid Americans from fighting on either side of the conflict, as well as closed down American ports to both French and British warships. Britain didn't like this, and they started capturing our guys, and to solve this, Washington and the Congress agreed to Jay's Treaty, which got the British to withdraw from forts that they had already said they were going to as part of the Treaty of Paris, and not much else. It was pretty unpopular, and the main reason that Washington said, you know what, two terms is enough for me. He declined to run for a third term as president. His farewell address, never actually delivered, but instead printed, reflected on his time in office and the precedents or traditions that he set, like the cabinet and neutrality and avoiding alliances, which most people don't understand correctly. Concerning alliances, it's not like he was totally against them. He just warned of permanent alliances that would become entangling alliances. He saw the purpose and benefit of temporary alliances. He also warned against political parties, a warning that was completely ignored in the election of 1796, which saw two very distinct parties emerge behind candidates John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. One could argue that with the Electoral College, a two-party system was all but inevitable, with like-minded causes, or at least groups that don't completely hate each other, combining together to become more powerful. In one corner, you had the Federalists and their candidate Adams. They typically favored a strong federal government, trade and banking, the North, and Britain when they had to choose. Their opponents were the Republicans, who were really called the Democratic Republican Party and would later splinter into the Democratic Party we know today. Totally not confusing, right? Well, they wanted to limit the government's power, fearing that it would threaten personal liberties. They appealed to small farmers, especially in the South, and they tended to favor the French, kind of like today's Republican Party, minus the whole French thing. They ran Thomas Jefferson as their guy, who lost to John Adams, who became our second president, and Jefferson, due to the Constitution, then became VP. Totally not awkward. Adams inherited a bunch of problems, a giant one being that France was now really mad about Jay's treaty and started messing with our ships. Adams sent delegates to France to try to smooth things over, and this resulted in the XYZ affair, in which French agents, referred to as X, Y, and Z, demanded a bribe from our guys before they could even meet with the French foreign minister. Yeah, we just got punked, and Adam was not happy about it, resulting in the Alien Act. This gave the government new powers to imprison or deport foreigners and made it harder for them to vote and become citizens. Adams and the Federalists also passed the Sedition Act, which essentially prohibited public opposition to the government. Over 20 newspaper editors were fined, arrested, or jailed under an early American cry of hashtag fake news. This did not go over well and led to the passing of the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions, which basically said that states could nullify laws that they deemed unconstitutional. This states' rights philosophy would totally never show up again. Oh yeah, the Civil War. Anyway, Adams, increasingly unpopular, would not win the election of 1800. That would go to Thomas Jefferson, barely. You see, Jefferson and Aaron Burr, both running as Democratic Republicans, had actually tied, and then it went to the House of Representatives to decide. But old Alexander Hamilton used his powers of persuasion to push the vote in Jefferson's favor, mainly because Burr was a giant jerk, and Jefferson won. Burr and Hamilton would laugh about it later. Wait, no, they would have the Burr-Hamilton duel a few years later, where Hamilton, against the act of dueling, either didn't shoot or shot up in the air. Now, Vice President Burr, well, he did not have the same reservations and shot Hamilton in the liver, and he died the next day. On a lighter note, the 12th Amendment would be passed, which made electors cast specific votes for president and vice president, basically making the party ticket that we have today. Yay, no more ties. Right off the bat, Jefferson had to deal with fallout from the Judiciary Act of 1801, which had created a system of regional courts around the country. Adams, in his final days as president, appointed hundreds of judges, ensuring that the courts would lean Federalist for quite some time. Adams also made John Marshall his Secretary of State, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, but these last-minute midnight judges had to actually receive the appointments for them to be legal, and some of them didn't. And when Jefferson took office, he saw that these undelivered appointments stayed that way. This led to Marbury versus Madison, in which William Marbury, a businessman who was supposed to receive one of these appointments, sued Jefferson's Secretary of State, James Madison, who he thought had a duty to deliver the appointment. John Marshall, remember him, led the Supreme Court in saying nope on the grounds that the court had no constitutional authority to make this happen. More importantly, this established judicial review, which is the principle that the Constitution is the supreme law of the land, it must be followed, and the judicial branch can nullify laws that it deems unconstitutional. Back to Jefferson, who believed in laissez-faire, or let it be, when it came to government matters. Let states, or even better yet, the people have the power instead of a large, dominating federal government. Cut to Napoleon Bonaparte, leader of France that by this time was basically taking on all of Europe. Rumor was circulating that they had just acquired the Louisiana Territory from Spain. Was Napoleon looking to take over the US? What Jefferson didn't know is that Napoleon was hurting in the Western Hemisphere due to Toussaint L'Ouverture and revolutionaries in the French Caribbean colony of Santo Domingo. Ironically inspired by the French Revolution, Santo Domingo rebels won their independence and France really had no longer any use for Louisiana. So when Jefferson sent diplomats to France to try and buy New Orleans, they were instead offered the Louisiana Purchase. Pretty much all of France's land from Mississippi River to the Rocky Mountains for just $15 million. Jefferson at first wondered, oh, do I have the authority to do this? But yeah, it was a deal that was too good to pass. Lewis and Clark were sent out into the Louisiana Territory to hopefully find the legendary Northwest Territory. Spoiler alert, they didn't, but they did find Sacagawea, the Shoshone woman who acted as their translator. Zebulon Pike also led two expeditions into the Mississippi Valley, the Great Plains, Rocky Mountains, Southern Texas, but nobody cares because what kind of name is Zebulon Pike? It sounds like an alien from a 50s B movie. I am Zebulon Pike, I will eat your brain. Internationally, Jefferson had to deal with the Barbary pirates from North African countries that were terrorizing ships and demanding protection from governments. European nations, as well as the US, paid this tribute unto the ruler of Tripoli demanded more. Jefferson refused and Tripoli declared war. Wow, our first war. Kind of. Yeah, we sent ships to blockade, but war was not actually declared despite the fighting. Tripoli promised to stop demanding tribute, but we still had to pay to get our prisoners back. Now, that might have been over in the Mediterranean, but we also had to worry about our shores here. The Chesapeake was an American ship that was attacked by the British HMS Leopard off the coast of Virginia. Between this and the impressment of our sailors, people were so anti-British that you thought it was the Boston Massacre all over again. Congress answered with the Embargo Act of 1807, which banned imports and exports from all foreign countries. That'll show them, right? Wrong. It basically killed our international trade while Britain just found different customers. And the Watered Down Non-Intercourse Act, which just restricted the embargo to Britain and France, yeah, it too was a failure. But all of these were issues that would be solved by the next president because we're out of time. Anyway, you should be good by now. If you think you're going to kill your test, give this video a like and let me know in the comments how you did. Also, make sure you subscribe because it's a long school year, but we're gonna get through it together. If you like my Spider-Man costume, or are you gonna buy anything on Amazon, why don't you click on my affiliate link? It really helps the channel. Be safe, happy Halloween, and I'll see you next time.